That became very clear to me as I was humming that song in my head, at a much lower note than earlier. Our scripture reading is going to come from Genesis 25, verses 21 through 23. And if you were here 2 weeks ago, this should ring familiar, as this is the scene in which we hear about Jacob and Esau and the nature of their relationship after birth. And so Genesis 25, beginning in verse 21. And Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife because she was barren. And the Lord granted his prayer. And Rebekah, his wife, conceived. And the children struggled together within her. And she said, "If it is thus, why is this happening to me?" So she went to inquire of the Lord in verse 23, and the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other, and the older shall serve the younger." And as I was going through that text about a month ago, as I was preparing for our series on Obadiah, The obvious nature of life in the womb became absolutely apparent to me, and it's a truth that I have known and believed for a long time. But as we read these truths in Scripture, we should be careful to hold them as actual truths in our own hearts. And I love the fact that God, in seeing what was going on in Rebekah's womb, is able to see not only the two children that are struggling and striving together in her womb, but can also see the nations that will also be born because of them. Didn't ask Becky to have Steve and the grandchildren stand up, but what a perfect example in our own day for that possibility. That as the child in her womb, now that we all know how old Steve is, there wouldn't be Abby, Lincoln, Micah, and Adrian. Had she made the choice, it was available to her to travel out of state. Yet God, in his infinite wisdom and in his providence, saw that Becky would make that decision and gave her the Holy Spirit's inclination to also say no to travel for death. And each Sanctity of Human Life Sunday that we've had here, we've done everything from talk about depressing statistics, which I think are important for us to be aware of. We've gone to texts like Psalm 139 and seen the fact that God knits humans together in their mother's wombs, and seeing the nature that God has created for the image of himself to be perpetuated in the world through the birth of children. And we've seen the value of that. This particular Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, I want us to have also not merely an emotional understanding of the atrocity that is the Holocaust of our day called abortion, but I want us to have a theological and a doctrinal understanding of how this is against God's plan for his image bearers. Because we can emotionally whip ourselves into a frenzy for any number of reasons, and I'll present to you college football for an example. I mean, I can remember 10 years ago, earlier on in my sanctification, being viscerally upset at bad plays and bad calls, as if a college football game had any bearing on my life. We can manufacture emotions. I can cry, or have a couple times anyways, when Jimmy Chitwood hits the winning basket in Hoosiers and it's not even a real game. But when your emotions are actually controlled and driven and shown a reality to them in Scripture, then we have a basis upon which to hang them. And I'm extremely thankful that the testimonies you have heard yet this morning did just that. There was no emotional manipulation. It's the fact that God has created life, and he's created life in the womb, and it's important and valuable to him and worthy of protecting. And I also want to make the case, and this truth is not has not been originated down the hallway in that study. This is not something unique to me. This is not even the statement I'm about to make is not even from me, and I couldn't actually find a historical originator for this statement, but it is absolutely true and has been said by many people over the decades that abortion is a Christological heresy. At which point you guys probably say that's 8 syllables. Please help. Christological meaning the doctrine or the understanding of who Christ is. And heresy, I think we all know that. It's the aberrant teaching. You take a truth and you twist it just a little bit. And abortion is actually a Christological heresy because it says that Jesus Christ in the womb was not actually fully human. Because if we don't think what is actually growing inside the mother's womb, which has been knit together by God Himself, is not fully human and is not deserving of every protection that God has given to us and those inalienable rights of life, let's just stop there, let alone the pursuit of happiness, then they must be subhuman. If life in the womb isn't worth protecting, then is it human? We afford more mercy, we afford more protections oftentimes to bald eagle eggs than a baby in the womb. And that's why I will argue, not originating with me, that abortion is a Christological heresy. It is teaching you that life in the womb, you're not actually fully human. And if Jesus wasn't fully human in the womb, then we've got big problems. So please turn in your Bibles to Luke 1. Luke 1 is such a beautiful scene. I love the fact that Luke captures for us some of the other historical figures around the birth of Jesus. You've got John the Baptist and his birth being foretold as it's told to his father Zechariah and his mother Elizabeth. You've got that scene in the early parts of the chapter, and about the middle part of the chapter we're told that Elizabeth is now conceived and she's pregnant, and then the angel Gabriel is sent to Joseph, Jesus's earthly father. He's sent to Mary. The angel says to Mary, "Do not be afraid, Mary." We've talked about that at Christmas time. You've found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. And verse 32, he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High and the Lord God, and will give to him, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. You've got the telling that it's a Holy Spirit imparted child that is being conceived in her womb, apart from any human intervention, that it's a supernatural occurrence of God to give Jesus Christ flesh in the womb. Verse 36, the angel still speaking to Mary, and behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. This woman, long barren now, is pregnant with her first child, a son. And this is the 6th month with her, so John the Baptist has a heartbeat. He probably has a fully formed skeletal system inside of his mother's womb. Verse 37, for nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, behold, I am a servant of the Lord. Let it be according to your word. And the angel departed from her. And then I love verse 39. So this scene moves forward. Mary's going to visit her relative. Verse 39, in those days Mary arose. Those days, meaning 6 months of birth or of pregnancy with Elizabeth. Verse 39, in those days Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to a town in Judah. And she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Mary is some days pregnant at this point. Because the day that she was told of this, Elizabeth was in 6 months of her pregnancy. She's just days pregnant Mary is. I mean, we're talking cellular level division. There's no spine. There maybe not is not even the beginnings of a heartbeat. There's probably just tissue, but fully human Jesus. It is because of verses like this that I am an abortion abolitionist. You will never find me cheering on and supporting heartbeat bills because that is incremental growth towards what we hope to be the protection of life, but it still allows the murder of a life at the cellular level just because the heart isn't beating. Take that theology, take that understanding to a cardiac unit and let me know how well you do when someone's heart is beating because a machine is helping it. Is that in life not also worth protecting because their heart isn't beating on their own? I would argue it is. And I would argue what we do in those hospital units is an amazing mercy of God to protect life. But this scene in Luke 1 demonstrates that Jesus Christ is fully human because he's referred to as Savior, he's referred to as the Son of God at the mere cellular level because we haven't progressed that far in the time period. You've got John the Baptist, 6 months, maybe roughly that size as the picture in the screen, in utero in Elizabeth, leaping for joy when Mary comes in the room because he knows that there's a Savior in Mary's womb and it is probably barely visible under the microscope. And I don't remember the last time anyone has jumped for joy over tissue. Maybe you've had a mole removed. Maybe it was cancerous, and you were joyful to have that removed. But was that a person? No. When Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, days after this prophecy, this promise that what is inside of her is from the Lord, the Holy Spirit is giving it to her, is the Savior, is the Son of God, is the long-expected Messiah, the one the world has been waiting for, the one that has been prophesied for thousands of years. And if any Jewish person of that day knew that that Savior was in Mary's womb as she made her way to Elizabeth's house, there would have been a parade. Everyone would have been leaping for joy, just like they were at his triumphal entry, because they wanted the Savior. And the baby leaps in Elizabeth's womb. Verse 42, verse 44 tells us why. For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Because the Savior is here. Not yet coming. He's here at that time. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord. And I know some of you aren't too thrilled when I talk about Greek, but take notes on some of this stuff. Now, again, not original with me, but some of this information, part of the reason why I actually really tried to concentrate studying Greek, I couldn't do Hebrew, was because it's so instructive. But the word child or baby here. Verse 41, the baby leaped in her womb is the Greek word brephos. If you're taking notes, you can write it in English as B-R-E-P-H-O-S. Brephos. That's the term for a baby in the womb in Greek. What's interesting is the term for a small child is brephos. There is no difference in the Greek language for the child in the womb and the child that is on your knee bouncing for joy, grabbing a bottle, playing with a block for the first time, keep them away from your cell phone. That child that is showing the ability to track his eye movements, as Sharon told us about earlier, that's a brephos. That child that's beginning to crawl and is maybe starting to rock back and forth and is pulling him or herself up on the furniture, that's a brephos. And the child in the womb, John the Baptist, 6 months in utero, is a brephos. There's no difference. The Bible does not differentiate in either Hebrew or in Greek for the life in the womb or the life of a young child. They are the same. You can make no argument that what is in the womb is anything less than a human, a baby, a child. The very thing that we go through extravagant lengths to keep safe in the car. I mean, you got to have like 12-point harnesses welded to the frame, rear-facing, surrounded by Charmin, if you even want to drive anywhere with your baby. I mean, never mind the fact that like we were in like cages or whatever, like metal, aluminum things that you would find at a carnival today. That's how we protect life, brephos, as a small child. Why wouldn't we offer that same protection in the womb? You can make no case for the disposable nature of life in the womb from Scripture. Zip, zero, zilch, and none. And anyone that tries to you is actually doing you a favor. They are showing you that they are a false teacher and that they are wearing wool clothing over their wolf fur. And that if their gums don't reveal them, they have sharp teeth and they want to devour. They're also doing you another favor. They're letting you know that they are of their father, the devil, Satan, who is a murderer from the beginning. John 8:44. Jesus is contending the fact of his real identity. Interestingly enough, he's contending that he is the Son of God. And the Jewish people are contending with their understanding of who this is and who the real Father is. If Jesus is the Son of God, then who's his Father? And there's some understanding that maybe Jesus was born of an illegitimate birth. All those rumors were circulating, and Jesus actually lets them know that if they can't even believe that, that they're of their father, the devil, who is a murderer from the beginning and the father of lies. And if you're going to call anybody a murderer from the beginning, you should probably have a pretty good standard upon which to base that accusation, shouldn't you? And I present to you all of Genesis, in particular Genesis 3 and 4. In Genesis 3, we learn that Adam and Eve, who are created in the image of God, the only part of humanity, all of humanity, humans, to be created in the image of God. Do you understand, let's stop for a second, that you are the pinnacle of creation? That you are worth more than a bald eagle egg or a whale or a sea turtle? Do we do things to protect them and not unnecessarily see them run amok? Absolutely, yes and amen. But you, human, are the only part of creation to bear his image. And God gave one commandment to Adam and Eve to not eat of the tree of the knowledge of the fruit of good and evil, right? And eat of that tree. Because in that day you will surely die. Death. Satan knows he doesn't have the ability to actually kill you, so what is he going to do? He's going to have you go ahead and try to have that happen by tempting you to sin. And Satan showed himself to be a murderer from the beginning by saying, did God really say? Why? Because he's thirsty for death. Why? Because he knows that his end is destruction in hell forever. From the very beginning, Satan has wanted nothing but death. Tempt Adam and Eve to sin so that they will die. And God in his infinite mercy didn't strike Adam and Eve dead in that day. They experienced spiritual death, yes and amen. But they also experienced the loving mercy of God to not strike them dead and to provide an animal skin to cover their sins as a foreshadowing of the Jesus' beautiful sacrifice and his gospel to come. But it wasn't just there. We're all familiar with the scene of Cain and Abel, I'm sure, as they both offered their sacrifices to God, one of the fruit of the land and one of his own making, so to speak. And God's happy with one and not the other. He's pleased with one and not the other. He's happy with Abel's and not Cain's, and Cain's not mad at God. He's mad at Abel. He's fuming. He's unrighteously indignant. And do you remember what God's warning to to Cain was. Be careful. Sin is crouching at the door. The sin of murder. The sin of anger. Anger uncontrolled. And he wasn't careful. He gave in to his heart. He gave in to the anger in his heart. Did not fall underneath the control of the Holy Spirit. And killed his brother. Because Satan was crouching at his door, seeking whom he can devour. And if Satan is the one who is a murderer from the beginning, and if we identify murder as the unjust taking of an innocent life, how could we ever be for abortion? This is not to sidestep the reality that having a child before you think you're ready is painful and difficult. This isn't sidestepping that at all. Because what does the church do in that instance? Shame and kick them out? Sadly, that's happened to our shame. No. Love and support. Because I like how Jessica worded it. Why compound one sin with another? Why, when sin is crouching at the door, should we open it? And I would argue that Satan is a murderer from the beginning because he knows the promise that God gave to all of humanity and to our first representatives, Adam and Eve, real historical human beings. They weren't monkeys, they weren't gorillas, they were humans. I believe the Bible. I'm not a seven-day creationist, a six-day creationist. God gave a strict warning to Satan in Genesis 3:15. It says, I'm going to put enmity between your offspring, all the other angels that fell with Satan. Satan had a very lofty position. He was above, he had a hierarchy of angelic structure. He was up near the top, and he fell and took a third of the angels with him. God is going to put an enmity between Satan and his offspring and the singular male offspring of the woman. And we know that singular male offspring of the woman came in Jesus Christ. But as that promise was given, that seed was planted in Satan to go after children. And we see it over and over again. Cain and Abel. I don't know how young they were. They were probably old enough to be adults. It sounds like they were on their own. But at that age, trust me, they weren't 25 and playing video games in their parents' basement. They were probably a lot younger than adulthood happens for us these days. And Satan was ready to go after the seed of the woman. I got to watch out for the seed of the woman because the part of that curse was you are going to bruise his heel, but he's going to crush your head. Satan knew that through a child someday would be born a savior that would crush his head, and he is so happy to go ahead and induce the idea of murder right from the start. And centuries later, you have another god by the name of Molech, who is not a real god, a figment of humans' imaginations, because humans like to control things. And if we can appease gods through sacrifices and through givings of certain gifts, we're really happy to do that, because maybe we'll get what we want from this god. God doesn't work like that. The true God, either. And there's a god named Molech. In Leviticus 18, verse 21, God warns the Israelites, because the Molech god is all around them, do not offer your children for sacrifices to Molech. Why? Because Molech is just another face and name for Satan. Because Satan loves to steal, kill, and destroy. He's a murderer from the beginning, and he's the father of all lies. And we've become pretty sophisticated in our day and age. We don't, you know, a lot of these things are relegated to the realm of mythology, and sadly all of religion often gets grouped in that too, that you and I are just, you know, fanciful mythologists. We're going to believe in something so that we can create some sort of placebo effect in our own hearts and minds, and maybe we'll feel better. God's true. There is one true God, and his name is Jesus Christ. So we're not dumb enough to fall for a Molech anymore. But thrones abhor a vacuum, just as nature does. And if you take Molech off, we will put convenience, we will put wealth, we will put ease, comfort, and all sorts of things on that throne. And sadly, Satan knows that abortion can feed those gods really well in our world today. We don't have Molech directly, but he's still active because it's Satan. And I would argue Satan is also the driving force behind Herod. You guys remember, because we just talked about this at Christmas time, that as the wise men didn't return back with reports of where Jesus is, what did Herod do throughout Jerusalem? He killed every male child 2 years and younger. He's a father from the beginning. He's a murderer from the beginning. He's the father of lies. And he's scared that someday that seed will be born and his head will be crushed. And I also think that Satan likes to crush our heads too. He wants to tell us that life isn't valuable. He wants to tell us that convenience and maybe travel or a healthy savings account are the true measures of life. Whereas Scriptures tells us over and over again that children are a blessing of the Lord. And that your quiver can be full of arrows from the Lord. And that life is valuable. And that life in the womb, from the point of conception, is fully human. If you have your Bibles open, we're going to close at Hebrews 2. And I want to land the plane on this Christological heresy, showing us that no, actually Jesus was fully human in the womb all the way through to his life and death on our behalf. He suffered in our place. And the author of Hebrews, as I so clearly established a couple of weeks ago, is Bob. He's arguing against the elevation of angels. I mean, this happens even today, so this is still relevant. In Hebrews 2, verse 5, the author tells us, "For it was not to angels that God subjected the world to come, of which we are speaking. It's been testified somewhere. What is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him?" This is all speaking about Jesus, he'll tell us in a second. "You made him for a little while lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor, putting everything in subjection under his feet. Now in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside of his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him, but we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone." Verse 10, "For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers." We can say brothers and sisters. Verse 12, "Saying, I will tell of your name to my brothers in the midst of the congregation. I will sing your praise. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children God has given me. Since, therefore, the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery." This verse tells us that Jesus Christ took on fully human flesh and blood. And if at any point he wasn't fully human flesh and blood, then you don't have a Savior. The blood of bulls and goats can't sacrifice for you. It can't stand in your place. The blood of an almost human isn't human, and it cannot stand in your place. Jesus Christ was fully human from the moment he was put in the womb of Mary on day one, all the way to the point when when he breathed his last on the cross, when he said, "It is finished." From minuscule cell. At that time, 2,000 years ago, not even aware that that was a case. They didn't even know a cell or an atom or a molecule existed. From that point, he was fully human. And this tells us, so does the gospel, that it was so he could stand in your place. Abortion is a tragic sin. It's terrible. It's awful. And if we call it a mistake, then you just need to do better. If you call it a slip up, then you just need to do better. But if you call it a sin, you can be forgiven. How many times can we point in Scripture to adulterers, murderers, liars, fornicators, traitors, and see them as objects of God's mercy and kindness? It's all over, isn't it? Isn't it the big names in Scripture? All but one, and his name is Jesus. And the only way any one of us sinners has hope is because of his perfect sinless blood shed on our behalf, standing in our place as a fully human substitute, but also being fully God, could absorb the wrath that we deserve and pay for it, absorb it, gone completely, and offer you forgiveness and new life here and now, and offer you a home in the church. Not ostracization, or however you pronounce that word. Being cast aside or given a scarlet letter. Heck no! I'd have a can of alphabet soup on my coat if I had to wear a scarlet letter for every sin that I'm guilty of committing. And I don't, because they're forgiven and they're gone from God's grace shown to me in Jesus Christ. So we can simultaneously stand strongly and without wavering for life and know that no matter how much culture and politics and society rails against you and calls you backwoods and backwards and patriarchal and not an anti-feminist, you can stand against all of that rubble and trash and know that you're standing on the firm basis and foundation of the Word, while also offering forgiveness to those who have both been in favor of and have committed that sin, and welcome them as a brother or sister in Christ, because their true brother is Jesus Christ, who can die for their sins and give them hope. It's only because of the wonderful grace and mercy and love shown to us in Jesus Christ that any one of us has hope. And it's only that hope that we should be standing on now. The unwavering, unshakable foundation of his word and the truth of his word, and be able to face political failures and go, "That stinks. It would have been nice. But the day after the elections, the hearts that were lost, unless it was by the grace of God, that were against the preservation of life, still were." I probably would have let the foot off the gas a little bit had Prop 3 failed. I'll admit it. I've been like, yes! And I would have hopefully celebrated rightly. That would have been a good thing. But would I have taken my eyes off the true prize, which is hearts being saved and transformed, and offering the mercy to somebody who feels the guilt of that decision? And saying you can be forgiven and you'd be welcome in our fold to grow and to love and to understand that you are his child? I don't know. We have some work to do, but we have a God who's faithful and strong, and it's from him we get our hope and our calling. So may we stand upon the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, as we fight for the voiceless and we give hope for the hurting. Because God did really say, and I'm glad he did, because otherwise his gospel would have some holes in it. And it doesn't. It's impermeable, perfect, and the word that saves. Let's give it voice, and let's be loving and hopeful. And please help me to do the same. I need it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you are the God of the impossible, that with you nothing is impossible. Father, may we not rest in political victories, and may we not think that this world is all there is. Father, help us to be a voice for the voiceless. Help us to be strong for the weak. Help us to rescue those who are perishing. Help us to be loving in offering the forgiveness of Jesus Christ to sinners of all stripes and colors, because we wear them all. And Father, help us to not lose hope. At a time where it's so easy to do that, may we look to Jesus for true victory as souls are rescued from hell and granted everlasting life in him forever. God, we leave this in your ever-capable, loving, and perfect hands. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand for our final closing hymn. With Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth, for you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Go this week and always hidden in Christ Jesus. Amen.